So in the first two videos, you have very clearly understood about chloroplast, its structure, its pigments. And now let's start with the actual process of photosynthesis. Guys, this photosynthesis occurs in two phases. The first phase, that's a light reaction, and the second one, that's dark reaction. In the previous slides also, in the previous video also, I've spoken about what is a site for light reaction and what is a site for dark reaction. But now we are going to talk about them in much more detail. In this particular video, I'm covering only the light reaction aspect. In my next video, I'll be talking about the dark reaction. So guys, these two processes, that's a light dependent or the light reaction or light independent reaction, that's also called dark reaction, are basically interdependent. Now, what do I mean by interdependent? मतलब एक दूसरे के ऊपर dependent है. Why am I calling it so? Because, children, as you can see, that light is entering during your light dependent reaction. Of course, the pigments are going to trap this light energy. They require water also. This water would be undergoing a process called photolysis, because of which oxygen would be given out to the atmosphere. Yeah? And you will have production of a very important high energy intermediate called ATP, and the second important, that is NADPH. ATP and NADPH, both of them are the products of light reaction. They can be formed only when you have light, you have water and pigments. So the product of the light reaction is ATP, and the second product, that is NADPH. As you can see in this particular image, both of them are utilized in your light independent reaction, which is also called dark reaction. How are they utilized? Carbon dioxide coming from the atmosphere is fixed and converted into sugar, that's glucose. This fixation would definitely require energy, that is in the form of ATP. And as you know, carbon dioxide is CO2 and your glucose is C6H12O6. So from where is this H coming? This H comes from your NADPH. So ATP is required. It's an energy molecule for any reaction happening in your body, animal body, plant body. Energy molecules are definitely required. And the second most important thing over here, that is NADPH, which is acting as the hydrogen donor. So both molecules, ATP and NADPH, are the products of your light reaction, which are utilized in your dark reaction. After utilizing, what do I get back? I get back ADP, IP, and along with that, I get NADP+. ठीक है, which would be again undergoing the light reaction, and they will again form ATP and NADPH. So with this, we clearly understand how important both the reactions are and how are they interdependent on each other. Okay guys, proceeding towards the phases of photosynthesis. As mentioned, the two phases of photosynthesis are light and dark reaction. We are starting with the light reaction, children. This light reaction is also termed to be photochemical phase. So light reaction, also called photochemical phase, you know why? Because it involves light, that's photo, and there would be chemical produced, that's your ATP and NADPH, as explained in the previous slide. Okay, so now children, what is the site of this particular light reaction? We have studied that as well, that the site for light reaction is the place where photosynthetic pigments are located, that's your grana. What is the aim of this light reaction? The aim of light reaction, children, it is basically an oxidation reaction in which your water is oxidized. Okay? Now, children, this particular light reaction or the photochemical phase, it includes four major steps. The steps involved, the first one, of course, pigments are going to show their activity first by absorbing light energy. So the first step is light absorption. The second step is splitting of water. As I told you, it's going to oxidize water. So our second step is splitting of water. Now when water is getting broken down or water is getting oxidized, oxygen would be released. That's your third step that happens. And lastly, children, the motto why reaction, this light reaction occurs is formation of high energy chemical intermediates. Yeah, so the formation of high energy chemical intermediates and which are those high energy chemical intermediates, children? Those are your ATP as well as your NADPH2. Okay, so children, now let's talk about the first step which comes under light reaction, that is absorption of light. We know who is going to absorb light. Yes, it is our photosynthetic pigments which are located inside the grana. But how are they going to function? We studied three different types of pigments, that's chlorophyll, carotenoid, phycobilins. Are they going to work in collaboration or they are going to work separately? Yeah, so let's understand this, that what exactly is the functioning aspect of these pigments. Children, there are multiple pigments present, which though are present in a scattered manner inside your grana, inside the quanta zone, but when they are working together. These pigments, children, they are organized into two systems. Yeah, the two systems are called photosystems. So let's call them photosystem 1, and I'm abbreviating it over here as photosystem 2. Children, these photosystems have been called 1 and 2 depending on the order of their discovery. It is not that photosystem 1 functions first, so it's called photosystem 1. It was discovered first, hence termed as photosystem 1. Okay? Now what does these photosystem contain? Of course, these photosystem, as the name says, photo is light, the light trapping units, that's your pigment. Photosystem 1 and 2, both of them contain your pigments only, which have been further divided into two parts. Your photosystem 1 and photosystem 2, both of them have pigments being divided into two parts. The first part, which is called light harvesting complex, and the second part, that's called reaction center. Children, same is with your PS2 also. It's called light harvesting complex, abbreviated as LHC, and the reaction center, that's abbreviated as RC. Now what is this light harvesting complex? Children, your LHC or the light harvesting complex has all the antenna pigments. What do I mean by saying antenna pigments? Antenna pigments are the accessory pigments, that is all pigments other than your chlorophyll A. And your reaction center, which is also called photocenter. Your reaction center, which is also called the photocenter, contains your main pigment. Which is the main pigment, children? The main pigment, that's your chlorophyll A. So your reaction center has chlorophyll A in both the cases. Yeah, and your light harvesting complex are basically the accessory pigments. So I'm mentioning it over here, children. This is the accessory pigment, which can also be termed to be the antenna pigment. Can you name these pigments, accessory or antenna pigments? This is your chlorophyll B, C, D, carotenoids, your phycobilins, all of them, which would come under your light harvesting complex. That's your accessory or antenna pigment. Now, the question arises that if light harvesting complex and the reaction center for both PS1 and PS2 are the same, then why do we have two systems? Right? Children, we have two systems, that's your PS1 and PS2, because these two reaction centers of PS1 and PS2 are going to trap light energy at different wavelength. So, your chlorophyll A, that is the reaction center of your PS1, is going to absorb 700 nanometers. And your PS2's chlorophyll A is going to absorb 680 nanometers. And that is the reason why your chlorophyll A is also termed to be, or I shall say your PS1 is also called P700, and your PS2 is also called P680 because of the wavelengths they trap. Now, what is the role of the light harvesting complex or the reaction or the antenna pigments or the accessory pigments? So, please have a look, children, at the diagram you can see over here. This shows the photon entering in here. There are multiple light harvesting complexes present over here. And over here, children, I'm highlighting this one. This is your main reaction center, that's your chlorophyll A. Now, what is happening in this particular process? Children, all these pigments, the LHC, the accessory pigments or the antenna pigments, are going to absorb light. In fact, your reaction center also absorbs light. So, what happens is, all the other accessory pigments are going to absorb light energy and they are going to pass it to your main reaction center, that's your chlorophyll A. Your chlorophyll A is going to do dual activity. It is going to take light energy from the accessory pigments and it itself is also going to trap light energy at 700 nanometers when we talk about PS1 and at 680 nanometers when we talk about PS2. And then it is going to conduct the light reaction, wherein you will have formation of the high energy chemical intermediates, that's your ATP and NADPH, which we'll be talking about in our subsequent slide. So children, I'm repeating the whole content now. Your light absorption is conducted by photosynthetic pigments, which have been divided into two systems, that's your PS1 and PS2. They have been named on the order of their discovery. Your photosystem 1 and photosystem 2, that's PS1 and PS2, both of them contain light harvesting complex and a reaction center. The light harvesting complex is made up of all accessory pigments or all antenna pigments, and the reaction center is made up of your chlorophyll A, the main essential pigment. Reaction center is also called photocenter. The difference between two systems over here is your chlorophyll A of PS1 is going to trap light energy at 700 nanometers, and the reaction center, that's chlorophyll A of PS2, is going to trap light energy at 680 nanometers. And hence, the alternative names of PS1 and PS2 become, PS1 is also called P700, PS2 is also called P680. The function of accessory pigment is to trap light energy and pass it to your chlorophyll A, the main reaction center. The function of chlorophyll A, the main reaction center, is also to absorb light on its own at 700 and 680 nanometers respectively in case of PS1 and PS2, and also take in all the light energy provided by other accessory pigments. Okay, children. So I hope light absorption part, the first step of light reaction, is very clear with everybody. So moving on towards the second and the third step for the light reaction. That is photolysis of water and release of oxygen. Guys, by the name itself, that is photolysis, we understand that photo is light and lysis, that is breakdown. Yeah? So, using light energy, there is breakdown of water. And when this breakdown occurs, oxygen is released. Now, what is this and where does this occur? Of course, if you are talking about action of light on water. And light inside the plant body is trapped by the pigments which are located in the grana. So I can say the site for this particular reaction has to be grana. Right? Inside the grana, or I should specifically say the lumen. You remember what is lumen? Lumen is the internal region of your thylakoid, the space present in, within the thylakoid. So the lumen side of grana or lumen side of thylakoid . This particular region will have a complex that is called oxygen evolving complex. So the lumen side contains a complex that's called oxygen evolving complex, abbreviated as OEC. It is oxygen evolving complex. All right. Children, for this particular process, you require certain important minerals. And this is a very important NEET question. The three minerals which are of utmost importance are manganese, calcium, and chloride ions. So for photolysis of water, three minerals important are manganese, calcium, and chloride ions. What exactly is happening? You have four molecules of water. You will get to know why have I considered four molecules of water in my subsequent slides. You have four molecules of water. In presence of this oxygen evolving complex, it gives out four protons as well as four hydroxyl group. In the later stage, I can mention the four hydroxyl group. Again, in presence of your oxygen evolving complex, I can write it as four electrons separated plus oxygen and two molecules of water. So guys, this is the release of oxygen that we have been talking about, and all these things happen only and only because of the presence of light. Yes, children, I hope this much is very clear with everybody. I again repeat, photolysis of water, that is splitting of water molecule due to the presence of sunlight. This particular reaction has to occur at the place where the pigments are located, and that site is grana, or the lumen site of thylakoid membrane, which contains an oxygen evolving complex, which is again going to be helping in splitting of water molecule, children. Other than the oxygen evolving complex, we have certain important mineral ions, absolutely important, in absence of which the whole process of photolysis of water is not going to occur. That's manganese, calcium, and chloride ions. Yes? So that's all with photolysis of water. And this particular thing was given to us by Robert Hill. In my first lecture, I had told you about this. Yes, children? Okay. Proceeding further. Yeah. Children, types of light reaction. The types of light reaction, we have two major types, that's called cyclic photophosphorylation and non-cyclic photophosphorylation. Now guys, what do you mean by photophosphorylation? Children, when I'm saying the term photo, in this particular case, if I'm telling you all the name over here is photo, again light is involved over here. Phosphorylation, the term phosphorylation means a combination of ADP along with IP giving you all ATP. Not to forget, the main motor of light reaction in the previous slides I have spoken about is formation of high energy intermediates. That is nothing other than your ATP. So children, cyclic photophosphorylation is production of ATP using light energy. Okay, children. So, as per my previous slide, I told you all that light reaction occurs in two types. That's your cyclic photophosphorylation and non-cyclic photophosphorylation. One thing is common between both, that it is a photophosphorylation step. That means there is an involvement of light. And in plants, wherever light is involved, definitely photosynthetic pigments will also be involved. In my last to last slide, I had mentioned about the pigments forming a system that's called photosystem. I had spoken about two photosystems, PS1 and PS2. Let us understand some more features of these systems. So guys, other than what you already know, that PS1 has a reaction center of which is going to trap light energy at 700 nanometers, and your PS2 is going to trap light energy at 680 nanometers. Other than that, some more important features of the same. So, what is the location of PS1? Of course, PS1 ho ya PS2 ho, both of them are located in your grana only, the grana only. But exactly, where is PS1 and where is PS2? So children, your PS1 is located at non-oppressed part of grana thylakoid. And stroma lamellae. And when I talk about PS2 is usually located at oppressed part of grana thylakoid. Now, I'm sure you must not have understood whatever I have mentioned. So let's understand the same thing in a diagrammatic manner. So guys, this is my individual thylakoid. Okay? This thylakoid, So this is how my thylakoid appears. So when I'm mentioning that my PS1 is located in the non-oppressed region, what I mean to say is it is located over here. Children, this region, or maybe this particular region is non-oppressed. Yeah, aap isko bhi non-oppressed bol sakte ho, ye region ko bhi non-oppressed bol sakte ho. Non-oppressed matlab nothing above it. Understanding? I'll redraw the diagram, children, because I did not show the stromal lamellae. Okay. Once again, this is my individual thylakoid. Yes. This is the stromal lamellae. Let's assume this is the stromal lamellae, children. This is my stromal lamellae. Okay. So, I was telling you all that the PS1 is present in the non-oppressed part. That is the exposed surface. Aapko ye surface exposed hai. Ye region bhi aapka exposed hai. I can't draw it over these regions. One second, I'll show you where. This is also my exposed region. तो यहाँ पे भी आपका PS1 प्रेजेंट है चिल्ड्रन PS1 को आई एम ड्राइंग इट विथ येलो दिस इज़ माय PS1 एंड दिस इज़ माय PS2 सो PS2 कहाँ लोकेटेड है PS2 द वन विच आई हैव ड्रॉन इन रेड इट इज़ इन द अप्रेस्ड पोर्शन अप्रेस्ड मतलब नॉट डायरेक्टली एक्सपोज्ड कोई ना कोई चीज़ उसके ऊपर नीचे प्रेजेंट है उसको हम लोग अप्रेस्ड बोल रहे हैं ओके And if I talk about, as I have mentioned over here, it is in the non-oppressed part of grana thylakoid as well as the stromal lamellae. Here's my stromal lamellae and this is my PS1. So children, the yellow ones are my PS1 and the red one located over here, this is my PS2. So I hope I have made it very clear where exactly is PS1 located and where is PS2 located. PS1 is present in the non-aprous region and your PS2 is present in the aprous part. PS1 aprous कौन सा region हो रहा है जो एक के ऊपर एक आ रहा है. स्ट्रोमल लैमेले इंडिविजुअल प्रेजेंट होता है, उसके ऊपर नीचे कुछ नहीं प्रेजेंट है. एंड दैट इज़ अ रीज़न वाई इट ऑल्सो बिकम्स एन नॉन एप्रेस्ड पोर्शन. एंड स्ट्रोमल लैमेले विल ऑलवेज शो ओनली PS1. मेक इट वेरी क्लियर चिल्ड्रन, स्ट्रोमल लैमेले विल ऑलवेज शो ओनली PS1. ओके, देन द सेकेंड पॉइंट ऑफ डिस्टिंग्विश, वी नो दैट द रिएक्शन सेंटर ऑफ योर PS1 इज P700 as it traps light energy at 700 nanometers and the same for your PS2 is P680. Okay, one more important thing to note over here children, your photosystem 1 is involved in both. It is involved in both, that is cyclic as well as non-cyclic photophosphorylation. Involved in both cyclic as well as non-cyclic photophosphorylation. Likewise, children, your PS2 is involved only in non-cyclic photophosphorylation. Okay guys, so now let's talk about cyclic photophosphorylation in detail. We got to know that photosystem is definitely involved, be it cyclic photophosphorylation or be it non-cyclic photophosphorylation. When I'm talking about cyclic photophosphorylation, you have only involvement of PS1. PS2 is not going to function when we talk about cyclic photophosphorylation. PS2 functions only for non-cyclic. And PS1 is known to work in cyclic also and in non-cyclic also. Now children, if I am telling you all that cyclic photophosphorylation is conducted only by photosystem 1, what could be the exclusive place where cyclic may occur? Your cyclic photophosphorylation is going to occur in your stroma lamellae or the stromal lamellae. If you remember the previous slide, stromal lamellae was having only PS1, right? The non-aprous region, stromal lamellae, was showing presence of only PS1. Now, when is your cyclic photophosphorylation going to start? When the reaction center, that is your chlorophyll A, is going to trap light energy of 700 nanometers. Right, children? Also, your NCERT mentions a statement that cyclic photophosphorylation occurs only when the wavelength beyond 680 nanometers are available for excitation of your chlorophyll. All right? Yes, children? So now, why am I calling it cyclic photophosphorylation? So firstly, children, the moment light energy, have a look at this diagram. The moment you have your light energy, which is absorbed by the chlorophyll P700, there would be electron released. This electron would be accepted by something called electron acceptor, and the electron would be transported via an ETS, that's an electron transport system. So when the electrons are transported via this ETS, that is electron transport system, there would be generation of ATP. Okay guys, so let's move on towards the first type coming under light reaction, that is cyclic photophosphorylation. You can see an image over here. Let's try and understand this image. It is an NCERT diagram itself. So here we have chlorophyll P700, that's my PS1, which is absorbing light energy and it expels out the electron. We have somebody called an electron acceptor over here, which takes up the electron and passes out to an electron transport system, that is ETS. At ETS, you have some series of reaction because of which you have ATP generation. and eventually the electron is again coming back to your PS1. So the initial donor of electron was PS1 and the final acceptor of electron is also PS1. This makes it a cyclic process. There was involvement of light energy, and that is why the term has photo in it. And as you can see, there is formation of ATP. That means there is phosphorylation. Like ATP is formed only when ADP and IP are combined together. Hence the name cyclic photophosphorylation. Okay? So now let's start. Now the thing is, children, the diagram given over here in NCERT does not mention the various intermediate electron acceptors. We are supposed to study about that as well, because NEET, you know, in NEET they may question us about the various electron acceptors. So let's start with that first. So guys, my photosystem involved in cyclic photophosphorylation is only one, that is PS1. So here comes my photosystem 1. As we have studied in the previous slide, any photosystem is made up of two components. There's something called main reaction center and the light harvesting complex. The main reaction center over here is your P700, that is a chlorophyll A molecule which traps light energy at 700 nanometers. And you have the LHC, the light harvesting complex, which is made up of multiple different types of your accessory pigments. So here comes up your accessory pigments, which are of different colors. Yeah. All of them together form this photosystem 1, that's your PS1. Okay? This PS1 is going to take up the light energy. This is a light energy. The pigments, all the pigments present inside your photosystem 1 are going to absorb this light energy, and due to so much of energy, electron would be expelled out. So, children, your cyclic photophosphorylation is a process of photophosphorylation in which an electron is expelled by the excited photocenter. So this is my excited photocenter, and it gives out the electron. For the first time, this electron would be accepted by a primary electron acceptor, and that primary electron acceptor is called FRS. This FRS stands for ferredoxin reducing substrate. Okay? The moment FRS takes up the electron, it will become negatively charged, but it is not going to keep the electron with itself. This FRS is going to pass on the electron to the next acceptor. And the next acceptor present over here is, guys, it is FD. FD stands for ferredoxin. So, FD stands for ferredoxin, and it is a second acceptor of electron. From FD, the electron is going to move towards the next acceptor. That's called plastoquinone, abbreviated as PQ. It is plastoquinone. Okay, guys. So the next acceptor in series, that is plastoquinone. Over here, children, I'll just quickly revise this much. Your main photosystem involved in cyclic photophosphorylation is PS1. Which is made up of both the main reaction center, that is your P700, as well as it has light harvesting complex. The moment it traps light energy, the electron is given out, and the primary electron acceptor present over here is ferredoxin reducing substrate. From where the electron is passed on to ferredoxin, that is FD, and it then passes it to plastoquinone. Now guys, from plastoquinone, the electron is given to somebody called a cytochrome complex. The cytochrome complex involved over here is cytochrome B6 and cytochrome F. So my next acceptor is a cytochrome complex which is made up of B6 and cytochrome F. From the cytochrome complex, the electron would be then given to the last acceptor other than PS1, the last acceptor, that is your PC. Guys, this PC stands for plastocyanin. Okay guys, so from your cytochrome complex, the electron is passed on to PC, that is plastocyanin. Children, one extra information about this plastocyanin I am mentioning over here. Your plastocyanin is a blue colored compound which contains copper. It's a blue colored compound which contains copper. Okay? It's a blue colored copper containing, you can compound ke badle you can call it as a protein. So blue colored contains copper. It's a protein. Okay? And now from plastocyanin, the electron would be sent back to your PS1. So as you can see, the initial donor of the electron was PS1 and the final acceptor is again PS1. This explains us the term, why is it called cyclic process. As light energy is involved, we call it photo. And now let's talk about phosphorylation. Children, when the electron is passing through plastoquinone, at this particular region, you have the reaction wherein your ADP combines with IP giving your ATP. This reaction over here is termed to be phosphorylation. So once again, a quick recap. Your cyclic photophosphorylation is the first one of the process happening in light reaction. Your cyclic photophosphorylation wherein your first photosystem 1 is involved, wherein your PS1 is made up of your reaction center also and your light harvesting complex also. The moment it takes in light energy, the electron is expelled out. The electron is accepted by ferredoxin reducing substrate. From FRS, it is passed on to FD. From FD, it moves on towards plastoquinone, wherein phosphorylation reaction occurs, wherein ADP combines with IP giving you all ATP. From plastoquinone, it is given out to cytochrome B6, cytochrome F, it's a cytochrome complex. And from there, it is passed on to PC. PC, that's a plastocyanin compound. It's a blue colored protein which contains copper. Eventually, from plastocyanin, the electron is given back to your PS1. Okay guys, I hope this much is very clear with you all. Yes guys, so we need to again remember over here that this particular PS1 is going to trap light energy at 700 nanometers. So the whole of cyclic photophosphorylation, will occur at 700 nanometers, or at times even it can occur when only light of wavelength beyond 680 nanometers are available. ठीक है ओके चिल्ड्रन सो नाउ लेट्स टॉक अबाउट द नॉन साइक्लिक फोटोफॉस्फोरिलेशन सो साइक्लिक फोटोफॉस्फोरिलेशन वॉज कॉल्ड सो बिकॉज द इनिशियल डोनर एंड द फाइनल एक्सेप्टर ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रॉन वॉज द सेम वन हु वॉज दैट वॉज योर PS1 और PE700 राइट. Let's have a look at the diagrammatic description given in your NCERT. Okay, so now children, it's the normal process of photophosphorylation only, in which the electron is expelled by the excited photocenter, that is your PS2, does not return to it. This is a major difference between cyclic and non-cyclic. In case of cyclic, PS1 gave the electron and PS1 was the final acceptor also. In this case, as you can see, there are two photosystems involved. You have photosystem 2 also and you have photosystem 1 also, right? So PS1 and PS2, both of them are involved in non-cyclic. In case of cyclic, you had just PS1. In case of cyclic, the initial donor and the final acceptor of the electron was PS1 only. In non-cyclic, it is not the case. Okay? So then the question arises, ki chalo theek hai, PS2 being the first photosystem to be active over here is going to give the electron. It's going to give the electron. And the same electron is not going to return to PS2. As I've been telling, this is why it is called non-cyclic. So from where is the electron coming back to PS2? If you have a look at the diagram clearly, children, here's the source of light. The light harvesting complex, I mean the pigments, are basically going to trap light energy. They're going to release electron. The electron is going to come out. Yes? And your LHC will become ionized. It will become positively charged, right? The electron which is given out here is not returning back. I'm again and again repeating this. The electron is going to go to somebody else. The question comes up, how will this particular LHC come back to its ground state? So children, please have a look over here. This is your water molecule. Due to light, when water splits, it's called photolysis of water. And when this water is splitting, two electrons are getting released. These electrons are going to go back to your PS2 and make this particular ionized PS2 go back to its normal state. So children, electron released during photolysis of water is picked up by the photocenter of PS2, that's called P680. Okay? Yes, so we have now understood why is it called non-cyclic, because the initial donor was PS2 and that electron was accepted by somebody else, and the electron which again went back to your PS2 was coming from the photolysis of water. Alright, now let's talk about it in detail. So now what's happening over here, children, while passing over the cytochrome complex, again over here you will have an electron transport system over here, check. The electrons are going to lose a lot of energy, and that energy would be utilized to form this particular ATP molecule. Okay? Yes, children? Now the question is, chalo theek hai. We got to know ki electron is not coming back to PS2. Where's the electron going? The given out electron is going to finally go to your PS1, and from your PS1 it is going to an acceptor that's called NADP+. Over here there's an enzyme working. The enzyme is called NADP reductase. This enzyme NADP reductase is going to help in conversion and formation of your NADPH. Alright, so guys, once again, PS2 was the first photosystem to get activated, and it has given out the electron. The electron is going to go towards ETS, that is electron transport system. From there, it's going to go towards the PS1. From PS1, it's going to go towards NADP, which is by the action of NADP reductase going to form NADPH. The electron which came back to your PS2 was given by photolysis of water. Yes, and as you can see the diagram, it is a bit zigzag manner, and that is the reason why your non-cyclic photophosphorylation is also called Z scheme. While the electrons are getting passed through the ETS, there is generation of your ATP molecule. Okay, so children, in both cases you have ATP formation in your cyclic photophosphorylation as well as your non-cyclic photophosphorylation. But other than ATP synthesis, in non-cyclic photophosphorylation, you have formation of NADPH also. Okay? Children, as we studied in detail about the cyclic photophosphorylation, the various electron acceptors, we need to talk about the same in non-cyclic also. We just really can't rely on this particular diagram given in NCERT, because it will ask us which are the intermediate electron acceptors in our NEET examination. Okay, so let's proceed with that, children, now. So guys, let's start now non-cyclic photophosphorylation in detail. So as in cyclic photophosphorylation, you just had PS1 over here. Both the photosystems would be involved, PS2 as well as PS1. And the process starts with PS2, your photosystem 2, whose main reaction center is P680. Yes. Also, it has the various antenna pigments or the accessory pigments, which are going to trap light energy at varying wavelengths. This forms the light harvesting complex. And the main reaction center, of course, your P680, which traps light energy at 680 nanometers. So all of them together are going to absorb wavelength of different, absorb light of different wavelength, and the electron would be given out. The first acceptor of electron over here, children, is a molecule that's called pheophyton. Just one second. Yeah, the primary electron acceptor, that's called pheophyton. Guys, again, NCERT doesn't mention about pheophyton. Okay. This is the primary electron acceptor of your non-cyclic photophosphorylation. The electrons given by P680 for the first time would be accepted by your pheophyton molecule. From pheophyton, the electron is then given to the next acceptor, that's called plastoquinone. That's abbreviated as PQ. From plastoquinone, the electrons move towards the cytochrome complex. The cytochrome complex, that is the same complex, your cytochrome B6 and F. From your plastoquinone, the electrons have moved to cytochrome B6, and from cytochrome B6, the electron is going to move towards the next acceptor, that's called plastocyanin, abbreviated as PC. Okay. Once again, guys, P680. Got excited by absorbing light energy. The electrons were first given to pheophyton. From pheophyton, the electron is moving on towards plastoquinone. From plastoquinone, the electron moved towards cytochrome B6. And from cytochrome B6, it is moving towards your plastocyanin. Children, please remember, it is a non-cyclic photophosphorylation, which implies that the initial donor and the final acceptor of the electron is not the same system. Okay? So from plastocyanin, the electrons are now going to move towards the next photosystem. Which is the next photosystem? The next photosystem over here is your PS1, which is known to trap light energy at 700 nanometers, which is also having the light harvesting complex made up of various accessory pigments. So these are the various accessory pigments. Okay? So this is your photosystem 1, which takes up the electron. Now children, like in cyclic photophosphorylation, plastoquinone was a place where ATP generation was seen. Over here also, you have ATP production observed at plastoquinone. That is, ADP and IP combines together to give you ATP. Okay? So the electron which is reaching your PS1 is actually a de-energized electron. And that is the reason why you require more amount of light energy to be absorbed by your PS1. So the moment PS1 again traps light energy, what happens is your electron is again given out. And this time the electron acceptor is the same, that's your FRS. From FRS, the electron is going to move towards FD. FD, that's again your ferredoxin children. So from FRS, the electron moved towards FD. And from FD, the electron is going to a complex that's called FNR. Guys, this FNR stands for flavoprotein NADP reductase. Flavoprotein NADP reductase. Guys, this is an enzyme complex. It's an enzyme complex that's called FNR, flavoprotein NADP reductase. Over here, children, this enzyme, that is flavoprotein NADP reductase, is the one which is responsible for formation of NADPH. Yeah, as the name says, flavoprotein NADP reductase. So this is the enzyme that is going to help in formation of this high energy intermediate compound that's called NADPH. Alright, now as you have understood that the electron has been travelled right from P680 to pheophytin, to blastoquinone, to cytochrome complex, to the plastocyanin, to FRS, to FD, and eventually it is coming to NADP. Electron ka source to hume pata chal gaya, but now what is the source of the hydrogen? What has, you know, which part has given this hydrogen to your NADP? So guys, electron source is a non-cyclic photophosphorylation, that is P680 se jo electron aa raha hai wo, and the source of proton over here, I am writing it like this, the source of proton is, please remember, it is stroma. It's a very important part to remember, children. You will understand the importance in this lecture only, in the further video. So please remember, the source of proton which helps in conversion of NADP to NADPH is definitely stroma. Okay, all right. Now the question arises ki chalo theek hai, P680 se jo electron nikla tha wo to pahunch gaya NADP tak, but P680 ke paas electron kahan se aayega? So guys, not to forget, in one of my slides I had told you all about the oxygen evolving complex. Do you remember that? I had mentioned that during your non-cyclic photophosphorylation, there is this oxygen evolving complex, jisko maine OEC likha tha. What happens over here? So you have water present. This water, due to light, breaks, matlab iske saath ho gaya photolysis, and it gives away the electrons to your P680, your PS2, the protons, along with that two protons are also getting released, and you also have oxygen that is released here. Guys, this proton would be getting accumulated inside the lumen. Lumen kya hota hai? Jo thylakoid ke andar ka space hai, uske andar ye proton accumulate ho jayega. So the electron has gone to P680, jiski wajah se P680 will come back to the ground state. Water ka jo proton hai, wo lumen mein jama hoga, it will get accumulated inside the lumen and will have a very important role in something called creating proton gradient. It is going to create proton gradient. Okay? Theek hai? So this is the function of the oxygen evolving complex. This oxygen evolving complex over here is going to be helpful in splitting water. Light ke help se water split hoga. Electrons would be given to P680. Protons would be getting accumulated inside the lumen, which is going to in future help in creating proton gradient. Theek hai? Okay. वन मोर क्वेश्चन जो तुम्हारे दिमाग में आना चाहिए कि ये प्रोटॉन का सोर्स अगर स्ट्रोमा है तो वेयर इज़ दिस NADP NADPH गेटिंग फॉर्म्ड. सो गाइज फॉर दैट प्लीज़ अंडरस्टैंड दैट योर NADP NADPH वाला जो कॉन्सेप्ट है, योर PS1 जो तुम लोग को दिख रहा है यहाँ पे, दिस PS1 इज़ डेफिनेटली इनसाइड द थायलाकॉइड मेम्ब्रेन में. लेकिन तुम लोग का NADP रिडक्टेज एंजाइम, तुम लोग का NADP NADPH, ये सारी चीज़ें तुम्हारे स्ट्रोमा में ही हो रही है. दिस पार्ट अगेन आई एम रिपीटिंग, डू नॉट गेट कन्फ्यूज. बस अभी नेक्स्ट एक दो स्लाइड्स में यू विल अंडरस्टैंड विच कंपाउंड इज़ वेयर एग्जैक्टली लोकेटेड. ऑल राइट, सो दिस वॉज माई नॉन साइक्लिक फोटोफॉस्फोरिलेशन. आई एम क्विकली टॉकिंग अबाउट इट वंस अगेन, आई विल रिवाइज इट. योर PS2 इज़ द फर्स्ट वन टू गेट एक्टिवेटेड बाई ट्रैपिंग लाइट एनर्जी एट वेवलेंथ ऑफ 680 नैनोमीटर्स. इट गिव्स अवे द इलेक्ट्रॉन टू द प्राइमरी इलेक्ट्रॉन एक्सेप्टर, दैट्स कॉल्ड फियोफाइटिन. From Phytin, the electron is moving towards plastoquinone. At plastoquinone, you have photophosphorylation, that is formation of ATP seen. From plastoquinone, the electron is transported to cytochrome B6 and cytochrome F, which is a cytochrome complex. From there, it moves on towards plastocyanin. Yes? And from plastocyanin, the electron is going to your PS1. Your PS1 gets de-energized electron, इसलिए वो फिर से लाइट ट्रैप करेगा एट 700 नैनोमीटर्स एंड इट विल पास द इलेक्ट्रॉन टू FRS, दैट इज़ फेरेडॉक्सिन रिड्यूसिंग सबस्ट्रेट. फ्रॉम FRS द इलेक्ट्रॉन मूव्स टूवर्ड्स FD, दैट इज़ फेरेडॉक्सिन. एंड फ्रॉम फेरेडॉक्सिन देयर इज दिस एंजाइम कॉम्प्लेक्स कॉल्ड FNR, दैट स्टैंड्स फॉर फ्लेवो प्रोटीन NADP रिडक्टेज, विच इज़ नोन टू रिड्यूस NADP+ टू NADPH. फॉर दिस पर्टिकुलर रिडक्शन द सोर्स ऑफ प्रोटॉन इज योर स्ट्रोमा. When all these things are happening, again you have photolysis of water happening over here, which is giving the electron to your P680, and the proton is getting accumulated in your lumen, which creates a proton gradient, which is very much helpful for production of energy. Okay? So now guys, if you have a look at the entire diagram, what you can see that this particular non-cyclic photophosphorylation has taken up a characteristic zigzag shape, and that is the reason why your non-cyclic photophosphorylation is also called Z scheme. आपको दिख रहा है एक typical zigzag shape है. Now why do we find such zigzag shape over here? This shape is formed when all the carriers are placed in a sequence on a redox potential scale. तो जिसका जैसा रेडॉक्स पोटेंशियल स्केल है वो उस पर्टिकुलर लोकेशन पे है एंड उसके थ्रू इलेक्ट्रॉन का फ्लो हो रहा है एंड दैट इज़ व्हाई इट इज़ अक्वायरिंग दिस जेड शेप और दिस एग्जैक्ट शेप. ठीक है. ऑल्सो गाइज व्हेन यू रीड योर NCERT यू विल फाइंड सर्टन टर्म्स लाइक अपहिल एंड डाउनहिल. लेट मी टॉक अबाउट दैट. नाउ एज यू कैन सी द फोटो सिस्टम टू the reaction center which is going to absorb 680 nanometers ka wavelength jo ki red light ka hota hai generally, wo jaise excite hoga it will throw the electron to the first acceptor, that is your pheophyton. Ab pheophyton se all the electrons are coming down, matlab this ye jo niche ki taraf aa raha hai, this is the downhill process. Okay, this movement of electron is downhill when we talk about its redox potential scale. अब यहाँ पर कहीं पर भी the electrons are not getting used up. वो सिर्फ आगे 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 पास होते जा रहा है. तो वो electron just पास होते जा रहा है, nowhere it is getting used up. And it reaches your PS1. PS1 पर भी वो excite हुआ 700 nanometers लेके और वो फिर से पहुँचा FRS के पास, that is your ferredoxin reducing substrate के पास. ठीक है, जिसका रिडॉक्स पोटेंशियल ज़्यादा है इसलिए ऊपर की तरफ जा रहा है एंड देन अगेन इट इज़ कमिंग डाउन. मतलब अगेन ये वाला भी डाउनहिल प्रोसेस है. सो जो मैंने अभी येलो में मार्क कर रही हूँ, दिस इज़ डाउनहिल एंड इवन दिस इज़ अ डाउनहिल वन. ओके, अब इस बार जो डाउनहिल हुआ है, मतलब PS1 से जो डाउनहिल हो रहा है, दैट डाउनहिल प्रोसेस लीड्स टू द प्रोडक्शन ऑफ द हाई एनर्जी इंटरमीडिएट कंपाउंड, दैट इज़ NADPH. ठीक है, यस चिल्ड्रन. So I hope with this you have understood the non-cyclic photophosphorylation very clearly. With this, children, I want to highlight few more distinguishing points between your two photosystem, that's your photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. Yeah, of course we know the location. We have already spoken about the location part, children, that your photosystem 1 is present in the non-appressed region, right? Non-appressed part of your grana thylakoid as well as your stroma thylakoid. This was the distinguishing point already discussed with you all. And your photosystem 2, which is present in the appressed portion or the appressed part of grana thylakoid alone. Children, if I talk about the content, the photosystem PS1 content, you have chlorophyll to carotenoid ratio. Chlorophyll carotenoid ratio in case of PS1 is high. But on the other hand, over here in case of PS2, your chlorophyll to carotenoid ratio is low. Okay, one more thing about the composition, children. Your chlorophyll A content is more than twice of chlorophyll B. In this PS1, your chlorophyll A content is more than twice that of chlorophyll B. Okay, and over here in case of your PS2, the content of chlorophyll A as well as chlorophyll B is equal. Okay, one more very simple point which you already know, the main reaction center is P700 here, and over here it is P680, the wavelengths they trap. If I talk about PS1, during non-cyclic photophosphorylation, it receives electron from PS2. PS1 receives electron from your PS2. And likewise, your PS2 receives electron from photolytic reaction. Hai na? It receives electron from photolysis of water. Okay, your PS1 by no chance is in relation with photolysis of water. Agar wo hota to cyclic photophosphorylation mein bhi dikha dete hum log photolysis of water. So it's nowhere involved with photolysis. और अगर वो photolysis में involved नहीं है, मतलब वो oxygen release में भी involved नहीं है, ठीक है? And this one definitely shows involvement. And last important point, your PS1 usually hands over the electron to NADP+ during non-cyclic, gives electron to NADP+, and over here it gives electron to whom? To your PS1. It gives electron to PS1. Okay, so few more distinguishing points I have added over here, children. Your PS1 is present in the non-appressed region, PS2 is in the appressed region of grana thylakoid. Exclusively stroma thylakoid shows PS1 only. Chlorophyll to carotenoid ratio is high in PS1 and low in case of your PS2. Chlorophyll A content is more than twice that of chlorophyll B in PS1, and both of them are equal in PS2. The main reaction center of PS1 is P700 and of PS2 is P680. Your PS1 during non-cyclic photophosphorylation receives electron from PS2, and PS2 receives it from photolysis of water. there's no involvement of PS1 when we talk about photolysis of water. And of course, wherever PS2 is there, you will definitely find photolysis of water and release of oxygen subsequently. PS1 finally hands over the electron to NADP+ during non-cyclic, and your PS2 during non-cyclic hands it over to PS1. Okay? With this, we move on towards distinguishing features of cyclic photophosphorylation and non-cyclic photophosphorylation. Let's talk about that. So guys, firstly, your cyclic photophosphorylation is conducted only by PS1. Non-cyclic is conducted by both PS1 as well as PS2. Both of them are involved. Okay? In case of PS1, the initial donor and the final acceptor of the electron is the same system, hence it is called cyclic photophosphorylation. But in non-cyclic, the initial donor and the final acceptor of electrons are different. In case of PS1, there is no requirement of any external source. Kis baat ka external source? Electron donate karne ke liye. So any external source of electron is not required. But over here, you do have an external source of electron, that is photolysis of water. In case of cyclic photophosphorylation, there is no photolysis of water, as well as there is no release of oxygen. ठीक है, बट यहाँ पे इन केस ऑफ नॉन साइक्लिक फोटोफॉस्फोरिलेशन फोटोलाइसिस ऑफ वाटर भी हो रहा है, ऑक्सीजन भी इवॉल्व हो रहा है. ठीक है, इन केस ऑफ योर साइक्लिक फोटोफॉस्फोरिलेशन यू हैव प्रोडक्शन ऑफ ATP अलोन. सो ये इट प्रोड्यूसेस ATP अलोन. एंड यहाँ पे इन केस ऑफ नॉन साइक्लिक फोटोफॉस्फोरिलेशन you have production of ATP as well as NADPH in dono ka production. Okay, now children, an important point to remember, they have not asked us about it, but you need to remember this thing, that your cyclic photophosphorylation, it occurs, or I should say, yeah, it operates under low light intensity. I said intensity, guys, not the wavelength. Okay, so it occurs only under low light intensity, or it needs to have some amount of anaerobic condition. You may provide an anaerobic condition, or when CO2 concentration is poor, CO2 availability is poor, in such condition you will have cyclic photophosphorylation going on. Okay, and when I talk about non-cyclic photophosphorylation, children, your non-cyclic photophosphorylation occurs or operates under optimum light intensity. Aerobic condition and CO2 presence. Now children, I hope you all have understood the non-cyclic photophosphorylation very nicely. Because what I'm going to teach next is an advanced version of the same one. If you still have doubts, you may go back, go through the that particular slide again and get it clear. I've been getting many doubts about this question, ma'am, what is chemiosmosis, what is chemiosmotic hypothesis? I'm going to talk about that in detail. But for that, I need you to learn non-cyclic photophosphorylation in great detail. Only then you will be able to understand my next part.
So children, this chemiosmotic hypothesis was proposed by somebody called Peter Michel. If you remember, when we studied about respiration, respiratory ETS, there was something called proton gradient, the term proton gradient introduced to you all. There was a gradient which is developed across a membrane, and the proton gradient is developed across a membrane, and then it leads to ATP production. This is what we had spoken about in mitochondria in respiratory ETS. Similar thing happens in chloroplast also. So to understand that, children, let's start. Chemiosmotic hypothesis, which was proposed by Peter Michel. The diagram given in NCERT for the same is a bit different. I'll come to that diagram as well. But first, I'm explaining you all in another way. So let's go through it. Again, I'm repeating. I hope non-cyclic is very clear. Only then you'll be able to understand this. Do not proceed if you have not yet understood or by-hearted the electron acceptors of non-cyclic photophosphorylation. You may pause the video over here and go back and revise it. And if it's very clear, let's proceed then. So guys, if I talk about the chemiosmotic hypothesis, which was proposed by Peter Michel, it again involves a proton gradient. Let's understand how. So, this is the membrane, the thylakoid membrane. This side is your lumen side, and this side is the stroma side. Lumen matlab kya? The internal space of the thylakoid. Aap log ke paas photosystem and the electron acceptors are present in some series. So let's assume you have your photosystem 2 over here. I'm calling it PS2. PS2 here. We all are quite aware that the light energy, light, of course, wo stroma se aayega na, light energy, so I'm showing it over here. The light energy is taken up by your PS2 in non-cyclic photophosphorylation, right? And the electron is given out. And simultaneously, children, when PS2 is there, you have photolysis of water. Lekin ye photolysis of water kidhar ho raha? It's happening in the lumen side. So I'm mentioning over here, water getting splitted, oxygen or hydrogen mein. ठीक है, और उसका इलेक्ट्रॉन किधर जाने वाला है? उसका इलेक्ट्रॉन जाने वाला है किसके पास? द इलेक्ट्रॉन वुड बी सेंट इनसाइड टुवर्ड्स PS2. सही बात है. जब PS2 एक्साइट हुआ, इट गेव द इलेक्ट्रॉन टू द नेक्स्ट एक्सेप्टर, और आई शैल से प्राइमरी इलेक्ट्रॉन एक्सेप्टर. एंड वो प्राइमरी इलेक्ट्रॉन एक्सेप्टर था फियोफाइटिन. फ्रॉम फियोफाइटिन इट मूव्स ऑन टू द नेक्स्ट वन. That's called plastoquinone. I'm not mentioning pheophyton over here because NCERT ne bhi nahi mention kiya hai. Hum directly next acceptor ka naam likhte hain. That is present somewhere over here. That's plastoquinone. So here's my plastoquinone, children. Guys, now you will get to know one more thing. Your plastoquinone, other than being the electron acceptor, it's a hydrogen carrier. So here's your plastoquinone. It's a hydrogen carrier. So when I'm saying it's a hydrogen carrier, it is the one which is known to pull protons from the stroma towards itself. So yahan pe kya ho raha hai? Yahan pe aapka proton present hai. Where's the proton present? Of course, in the stroma it is present. The protons are pulled by the action of plastoquinone. Kab pull karega wo? Jab hi uske paas electron aayega. So, the electron is given from PS2 to your plastoquinone. Kaun ja raha hai ye? Electron ja raha hai. So, when the electron is reaching the plastoquinone, jaise aapne ETS respiration mein padha tha, complexes se when electrons are getting passed, they pull proton from the matrix or the stroma. Likewise, over here, plastoquinone will pull proton from the stroma. It's going to pull proton from the stroma, and your plastoquinone will convert and form something called reduced plastoquinone. So it takes up the proton from the matrix, the electron from PS2, and it converts into a reduced form, that is reduced plastoquinone. ठीक है, कब तक इसके पास रहने वाला है प्रोटॉन एंड इलेक्ट्रॉन? जब तक नेक्स्ट एक्सेप्टर नहीं आता. एंड इफ यू रिमेंबर द नेक्स्ट एक्सेप्टर इन द सीरीज वॉज योर साइटोक्रोम सिस्टम और द साइटोक्रोम कॉम्प्लेक्स. सो हियर कम्स माई साइटोक्रोम कॉम्प्लेक्स, लेट्स कॉल इट साइटोक्रोम B6 एंड F. सो द इलेक्ट्रॉन चिल्ड्रन, द इलेक्ट्रॉन फ्रॉम योर प्लास्टोक्विनोन इज गोइंग टू गो टू हुम? Children, the electron is going to go to whom? It's going to go towards cytochrome complex, right? So here the electron moves towards the cytochrome complex, and where does the proton go? The proton, guys, the proton is sent inside the lumen. Okay, guys, I made a mistake over here. Yeah, this is proton. ठीक है, so already you had a proton present over here because of photolysis of water, and now आपका प्लास्टोक्विनोन से भी the proton is sent here. Where's the electron? The electron goes to your cytochrome complex, and that's how your PQH2, the reduced form, converts back to PQ. I'm repeating this much, children. We had our PS2, it has absorbed light energy. Also, water has got splitted. The electron from PS2 is going on towards phlogiston, but I have not mentioned it as NCERT doesn't mention in its diagram. They directly mention PQ. Plastoquinone, rather than being an electron acceptor, is a hydrogen carrier. So the moment electron reaches plastoquinone, it pulls in proton from the stroma. And this particular proton is sent to the lumen side of the thylakoid. And the electron is passed to your cytochrome complex. Okay? From cytochrome complex, children, the electron is passed to somebody called PC, that is plastocyanin. I am mentioning over here, the electron is sent to plastocyanin. And from plastocyanin, children, the electron is passed to the next photosystem. That's your photosystem 1. That's your PS1. So plastocyanin ke paas electron kahan se aa gaya hai? It has come from your cytochrome complex. Right? And this electron is passed to this electron is passed to your PS1. Now children, your PS1 is going to pass the electron to the next in the series, that is FRS and FD, right? And FD say, so I'll just mention over here, your PS1 passes it to FD, and from FD it goes to your FNR, that is your flavoprotein ferredoxin NADP reductase. Or flavoprotein NADP reductase. This is an enzyme complex, guys, and this enzyme complex is known to form NADPH. How does it form NADPH? You have your NADP, which is converted to form the electron has been accepted by NADP over here. You have lots and lots of protons getting accumulated in the lumen side. Why? Because photolysis of water ho raha hai. So here's the photolysis of water wala part, which is continuously going on, and simultaneously whenever you have this plastoquinone, it keeps on pulling protons from the stromal region. So guys, because of this, the lumen of the thylakoid becomes enriched with protons. Do reason maine aapko bataya, ek photolysis of water ki wajah se, and dusra, the primary electron acceptor as mentioned in NCERT is a hydrogen carrier. So every time it is going to carry an electron, it pulls proton from the stroma and pushes it into the lumen. Aur kab push karega? When it loses the electron.
It loses electron to whom? It loses the electron to the next one, next in the series, that is your cytochrome complex. From cytochrome complex, it goes to PC, that is your plastocyanin, and from plastocyanin, the electron is passed to your PS1. When electron is passed to PS1, it sends it to FRS, it sends it to FD, and eventually FNR, that's an enzyme complex, which reduces NADP plus to your NADPH. Alright? I did not mention a plus over here. NADP plus to NADPH. Okay? Now the three events which are happening, kaun se teen events? Photolysis of water, lumen mein proton jama ho gaya. Second was plastoquinone ke action ki wajah se more protons getting accumulated. And the third thing, NADP is utilizing the proton and converting into NADPH. Because of the three things, what's happening is, the consequence of the three events is that the concentration of protons decreases in the stroma. But in the lumen, the concentration of proton has kept on increasing. And this develops a proton gradient. So for our convenience, I'm just mentioning a lot of plus charge over here, that is in the lumen side, and less of plus charge over here. Okay? Now the proton gradient, jo aapko dikh raha hai, this proton gradient has to be broken. Now how and who is going to break the proton gradient? The proton gradient is broken down due to the movement of protons through the transmembrane channel. Now what is this transmembrane channel? It is the CF0 region of ATPase. So guys, as you had the complex 5 in respiration ETS, you also have it over here in your chloroplast. This is the membrane. This is the stromal side. At the stromal side, you have the head region projected of ATP synthase, and this is the basal part of it. This basal part of it is your CF0 region, that is chloroplast F0 region, and ATP synthase head region is your CF1 region. Okay? So now what's going to happen is, lots and lots of protons which are getting accumulated in the lumen, the red ones which I have marked over here are the protons, are going to accumulate towards the CF0 region. Over here, you have high electrochemical proton gradient. Okay? And this side, you have the low proton gradient. So the movement is going to happen in this particular direction. Alright? The movement is going to happen in this particular direction. That is, from the lumen side, it is going to move towards the stromal side. Is that very clear, children? I repeat this part. The gradient is broken down due to the movement of protons across the membrane to the stroma through the transmembrane channel of your CF0 and CF1. Now, in this particular CF1 region, children, not to forget, it's the same F1 particle which has an enzyme that is called, I'm mentioning over here, ATP synthase. This ATP synthase contains again the two parts, that is CF0, that is embedded in the thylakoid. Guys, this is a thylakoid membrane. I'm sorry, I forgot to mention it over here. This is the thylakoid membrane. So the CF0 region is embedded in the thylakoid membrane and forms a transmembrane, matlab across the membrane ek channel bana raha hai. Aur ye channel ki wajah se, there would be a facilitated diffusion of these protons. यहाँ पे जितने भी प्रोटॉन्स हैं इनको एक फैसिलिटेटेड डिफ्यूजन के थ्रू इज गोइंग टू क्रॉस एंड रीच द स्ट्रोमा विच इज़ द अदर पार्ट ऑफ इट द अदर पोर्शन ऑफ इट इज कॉल्ड CF1 दिस द वन विच इज प्रोट्रूडिंग आउट हियर दिस इज योर CF1 रीजन ओके दिस CF1 प्रोट्रूड्स ऑन द आउटर सर्फेस ऑफ द थायलाकॉइड मेम्ब्रेन और कौन से साइड में जहाँ पे आपका स्ट्रोमा फेस कर रहा है ये ऊपर वाला रीजन जो है वो स्ट्रोमल रीजन है. तो CF1 protrudes towards the stroma and CF0 is embedded. ठीक है. Now the breakdown of the gradient provides enough energy to cause a conformational change of this CF1. आपका जो CF1 region है, this portion is going to show a conformational change. मतलब conformation क्या होता है? Conformation होता है shape. So there is a conformational change seen over here in the CF1 particle of the ATP, which makes enzyme synthesize multiple molecules of ATP. मतलब यहाँ पे क्या होगा guys? In this portion, जैसे ही तुम्हारा ATP synthesis is located over here, your ADP will combine together with IP forming ATP. ठीक है. So as I told you, chemiosmotic hypothesis also deals with the proton gradient and it leads to production of ATP. Let's do this once again. So this is the non-cyclic photophosphorylation in a different manner. I have represented it. I have this white colored thing, that is my thylakoid membrane. Outside to that I have shown stroma, and inner to it I have shown the lumen, the thylakoid internal lumen, the space. So what's happening is your PS2 is going to trap light energy, and because of that the electron will get excited, it will move towards plastoquinone. Simultaneously your water is also getting lysed, that is photolysis of water, and the electron is going back to your PS2. So PS2 aa gaya ground state mein, usne apna electron lose kar diya tha, but it has come back to the ground state now. But you have an additional amount of proton present inside the lumen. PS2 sends electron to the next in the list, that is plastoquinone. Plastoquinone is a hydrogen carrier. Matlab wo electron carry nahi karega akela. So it pulls in proton from the stromal region and converts into PQH2, that is a reduced plastoquinone. Uske paas electron PS2 ne de hi diya tha aur usne proton le liya stroma se. वो अपने पास प्रोटॉन तब तक ही रखेगा जब तक उसके पास इलेक्ट्रॉन है. द इलेक्ट्रॉन इज मूविंग टू B6, साइटोक्रोम B6NF, एंड इमीडिएटली वो प्रोटॉन को बाहर भेज देता है. बाहर मतलब ल्यूमेन में रख लेता है, सॉरी अंदर. ठीक है. द इलेक्ट्रॉन इज पास टू साइटोक्रोम B6F कॉम्प्लेक्स, फ्रॉम वेयर द इलेक्ट्रॉन मूव्स ऑन टूवर्ड्स प्लास्टोसाइनिन. प्लास्टोसाइनिन गिव्स द इलेक्ट्रॉन टू योर PS1. नॉट टू फॉरगेट, योर PS1 इज ऑल्सो गोइंग टू टेक अप द लाइट एनर्जी. PS1 passes electron to ferredoxin. Your ferredoxin passes it to FNR. FNR stands for flavoprotein NADP reductase, which is an enzyme complex responsible for formation of NADPH. ठीक है. Now guys, as and when the non-cyclic photophosphorylation is on, what happens is there is a lot of proton gradient or lot of proton concentration seen inside the lumen. This high electrochemical proton concentration gradient has to be broken, and it breaks because of your ATP synthase complex as seen in the form of complex 5 in your respiratory ETS. Over here also you have this particular complex, that's CF0 and CF1. CF0 is the one which is embedded in the thylakoid membrane. This is the thylakoid membrane, it is embedded in the thylakoid membrane, and CF1 is the one which is protruding outside. There is a conformational change. There is a conformational change seen in your CF1 region. मतलब उसका शेप हल्का सा चेंज होता है, एंड जैसे जैसे उसमें से प्रोटॉन पास होंगे वैसे वैसे यू विल हैव द फॉर्मेशन ऑफ ATP. ओके. नाउ चिल्ड्रन, विल कंसिडर द डायग्राम गिवन इन NCERT एंड देन टॉक अबाउट chemiosmotic hypothesis. I hope you have understood the different description which I gave, I mean the different representation which I gave for chemiosmotic hypothesis. Now let's have a look at the NCERT diagram. So guys, again I'm repeating for you all, chemiosmotic hypothesis was given by Peter Michel. Like in respiration, we had our ETS, respiratory ETS, which led to ATP generation. Over here also in photosynthesis, it is similar, you know, there's a development of proton gradient across a membrane, and the membrane involved over here is a thylakoid membrane. In case of your respiration, you had it like all the protons were getting accumulated in the intermembranous space. Over here the protons are getting accumulated in the lumen. Okay, so let's have a look at this diagram now and understand what they want to speak about. So, children, the first thing, please remember, the first thing, even in NCERT they have mentioned as under the first point, that photolysis of water leads to increase in proton concentration in the lumen. So this is my first point over here. There is photolysis of water happening, and ye photolysis of water ki wajah se you have proton getting accumulated. This is my first point. ठीक है, और प्रोटॉन किधर अक्यूमुलेट हो रहा है? प्रोटॉन अक्यूमुलेट हो रहा है इन द ल्यूमेन. ठीक है, सो स्प्लिटिंग ऑफ वाटर अकर्स बिकॉज ऑफ लाइट, दैट्स वाई वी कॉल इट फोटोलाइसिस ऑफ वाटर. ऑक्सीजन इज गिवन आउट एंड प्रोटॉन इज अक्यूमुलेटेड इन द ल्यूमेन. माई सेकेंड पॉइंट इज अबाउट द हाइड्रोजन कैरियर. मैंने आपको पिछले स्लाइड में भी बताया था कि एज इलेक्ट्रॉन्स आर मूविंग थ्रू द फोटो सिस्टम, प्रोटॉन इज ट्रांसपोर्टेड अक्रॉस द मेम्ब्रेन. कहाँ से आया? स्ट्रोमा से आया. क्यों आया ये? बिकॉज द एक्सेप्टर ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉन प्लास्टोक्विनोन इज एक्चुअली अ हाइड्रोजन कैरियर. ठीक है, सो दिस हैपन्स बिकॉज द प्राइमरी एक्सेप्टर ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉन विच इज लोकेटेड इन द थायलाकॉइड मेम्ब्रेन इज एक्चुअली अ हाइड्रोजन कैरियर. तो वो क्या करेगा? माई सेकेंड पॉइंट is regarding the plastoquinone. वो क्या करेगा? वो hydrogen protons pull कर लेगा from the stroma. It will take the electron from the PS2 and it will get reduced to BQH2 as you can see in the diagram. ठीक है, till when will it have the hydrogen or the proton with it? Till the time electron is passed. The next acceptor of the electron is cytochrome complex. Electron जैसे cytochrome complex के पास चला जाएगा, the proton would be released here. Where is it released? Again the proton is released in the lumen. तो lumen में protons accumulate होने के दो reasons आए अभी तक. पहला reason photolysis of water, दूसरा reason plastoquinone which is a hydrogen carrier. ठीक है, my third point which I want to talk about is the enzyme, that enzyme complex that is your FNR. This is the NADP reductase complex complex which is located in the stroma side of the membrane. वो क्या कर रहा है? NADP को कन्वर्ट कर रहा है इनटू NADPH. ठीक है, सो हेंस विद इन द क्लोरोप्लास्ट प्रोटॉन्स इन द स्ट्रोमा डिक्रीज इन नंबर. तो यू हैव मोर नंबर ऑफ प्रोटॉन्स, या यू हैव मोर नंबर ऑफ प्रोटॉन्स इन द ल्यूमिन एंड लेस नंबर ऑफ प्रोटॉन्स इन द स्ट्रोमल रीजन. ठीक है, मतलब क्या डेवलप हो चुका है? इट हैज़ क्रिएटेड अ प्रोटॉन ग्रेडियंट. अच्छा, मोर नंबर ऑफ प्रोटॉन्स आर प्रेजेंट इन द ल्यूमिन, मतलब ऑटोमेटिकली ल्यूमिन का पीएच को क्या होगा? पीएच विल डिक्रीज. ठीक है, सो लेट मी नोट डाउन द सेम पॉइंट्स व्हिच आई हैव स्पोकन अबाउट सो दैट इवन यू कैन मेक नोट्स. चिल्ड्रन, आई विल बी यूजिंग द सिमिलर कलर. My first point is regarding the photolysis of water. This is the first thing, कि पानी स्प्लिट हो रहा है, एंड जैसे जैसे पानी स्प्लिट हो रहा है, what's happening? Proton concentration increases in the lumen. So photolysis of water occurs, increasing the protons present in lumen. ठीक है, तो पहले लेवल पे तुमने प्रोटॉन्स का कॉन्सेंट्रेशन बढ़ा लिया है. व्हाट वाज द फर्स्ट थिंग? फोटोलाइसिस. द सेकंड थिंग एज आई हैव स्पोकन अबाउट, माय सेकंड पॉइंट इज रिगार्डिंग द हाइड्रोजन कैरियर. योर प्लास्टोक्विनोन इज अ हाइड्रोजन कैरियर. सो व्हाट डज प्लास्टोक्विनोन डू? प्लास्टोक्विनोन पुल्स प्रोटॉन फ्रॉम द स्ट्रोमा. देयरफॉर एज इलेक्ट्रॉन्स रीच PQ, it pulls proton from stroma. ठीक है, and forms its reduced form, that is PH2. So the two points I have covered, as I have marked in the diagram, children, similar color I am using for the write up also, so it's very clear with you all. Third point, I'm going to talk about the enzyme NADP reductase. Yeah, So guys, where is this NADP reductase located? It is located on the stroma side of the membrane. Here's the enzyme, the stroma side of the membrane. Okay? Along with the electrons that come from the acceptor of PS1, protons are necessary for the reduction of NADP also. And from where are these protons going to come? They are going to come from stroma again. So guys, my third point is it regarding your NADP reductase. पहले तो आपको जानना है कि इसका लोकेशन क्या है. इट इज़ लोकेटेड ऑन द स्ट्रोमा साइड ऑफ मेम्ब्रेन. ठीक है. सो अलॉन्ग विथ विच एवर इलेक्ट्रॉन्स आर कमिंग फ्रॉम द PS1 रीजन, प्रोटॉन्स हमको चाहिए. दिस NADP रिडक्टेज का फंक्शन क्या है? इट इज़ नोन टू कन्वर्ट योर NADP टू NADPH. ठीक है. सो योर NADP प्लस इज गोइंग टू गेट कन्वर्टेड टू NADPH. फ्रॉम वेयर इज द इलेक्ट्रॉन गोइंग टू कम? गाइस, द इलेक्ट्रॉन कम्स फ्रॉम योर FRS, FRS से FD एंड FD गिव्स इट टू NADP. सो द सोर्स ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉन इज इलेक्ट्रॉन सोर्स इज योर FD. And the source of proton for this particular reaction is your stroma. So what does this mean now, guys? This means that more proton has been pulled up from the stroma. This also reduces the content of protons in your stroma. ठीक है. So यहाँ पे आपको चाहिए electron as well as protons, and this is fulfilled using electron source is your ferredoxin and the proton source is your stroma. Hence, within the chloroplast, protons in the stroma decrease in number, while in the lumen it keeps on increasing. So due to the first three points mentioned over here, I'm mentioning over here, protons present in stroma, what happens to that? It decreases. And the protons present in your lumen keeps on increasing. Right, children? Also, due to this, the pH of your lumen, what has happened to the pH? Agar proton concentration badhte ja raha hai, to pH kya ho jayega? Kam ho jayega. It will decrease. Theek hai? So this is the inference of the first three steps what we spoke about. Now what happens to the proton gradient? Let's talk about that. Guys, the gradient is very much important because its breakdown is going to lead to ATP formation. So guys, this gradient is broken down due to the movement of protons across the membrane. Across the membrane matlab kahan se kahan? The movement is going to occur somewhat like this. The protons from the lumen are going to pass on towards the stromal region. Okay? Now, ye log pass kaise honge? Pass hone ke liye koi jagah to chahiye? Is going to occur through the transmembrane channel of CF0 of the ATP synthase. Children, if you remember the respiratory ETS, we had spoken about the ATP synthase complex, jiska F0 region is embedded in the membrane and the F1 region is protruding outside. Exactly waisa aapko dikh raha hai ye complex. Please have a look at it very carefully, children. This is the ATP synthase complex. This region, this one. ये उसका दिस पोर्शन इज़ द CF0 पोर्शन एंड जो बाहर प्रोट्रूड कर रहा है दैट इज़ योर CF1 पोर्शन. सो दिस इज़ द CF0 एंड जो बाहर प्रोट्रूडिंग है दैट इज़ CF1 एज मेंशन इन द डायग्राम. ऑलराइट. सो CF0 रीजन इज़ द ट्रांसमेम्ब्रेन चैनल जिसके थ्रू प्रोटॉन्स आने वाले हैं. ठीक है. ये एंटायर कॉम्प्लेक्स को हम ATP सिंथेस कॉम्प्लेक्स बुलाते हैं जिसका CF0 रीजन एम्बेडेड है मेम्ब्रेन के अंदर, थायलाकॉइड मेम्ब्रेन के अंदर, जो एक ट्रांस मेम्ब्रेन चैनल बनाने वाला है एंड विच विल हेल्प इन द फैसिलिटेटेड डिफ्यूजन ऑफ प्रोटॉन्स अक्रॉस द मेम्ब्रेन. ठीक है. द अदर पोर्शन ऑफ इट इज़ द CF1 और ये CF1, अच्छा, जैसे ही प्रोटॉन्स उसके थ्रू पास होने वाला है, जैसे ग्रेडियंट का ब्रेकडाउन होगा, it will release enough energy to cause a conformational change in the CF1 portion. ठीक है. द ये जो ATP सिंथेस का CF1 रीजन है दैट विल शो अ कॉन्फर्मेशनल चेंज, और ये कॉन्फर्मेशनल चेंज की वजह से इट विल मेक द एंजाइम सिंथेसाइज सेवरल मॉलिक्यूल्स ऑफ ATP. जितना भी तुम लोग को यहाँ पे ATP सिंथेसिस दिख रहा है दैट इज़ डन बाय द ATP सिंथेस. ओके, सो व्हाट वुड बी माय फिफ्थ पॉइंट अबाउट? नाउ हाउ इज़ द ग्रेडियंट ब्रोकन डाउन चिल्ड्रन? जितना भी प्रोटॉन्स अंदर है दैट वुड बी पास्ड यूजिंग द ट्रांसमेम्ब्रेन चैनल. सो द ग्रेडियंट इज ब्रोकन डाउन by passing protons through transmembrane channel. Okay, किसका channel है ये? Channel of CF0 of your ATP synthase. As I've been repeating, the CF0 1 is embedded one and the CF1 region is protruding one. So ATP synthase, CF0, so this is the one which is embedded. In thylakoid membrane okay, and the CF1 portion that is protruding out. So protons are transported through your facilitated diffusion. As and when the protons are passing, what happens is there is a conformational change. Where is the conformational change seen? The conformational change is seen in the CF1 portion. ओके, CF1 पोर्शन हो, CF0 पोर्शन हो, किसका पोर्शन है वो? इट इज़ ऑफ योर ATP सिंथेस. सो देयर इज अ कॉन्फर्मेशनल चेंज इन द CF1 पार्टिकल ऑफ ATP सिंथेस विच मेक्स द एंजाइम. दिस कॉन्फर्मेशनल चेंज वुड लीड टू सिंथेसिस ऑफ ATP. कैसे करेगा वो? ADP और IP को कंबाइन करके, मतलब इट्स फॉस्फोरिलेशन. All right, guys. Yes. So this is all about chemiosmosis. I hope it's very clear with you all.